Good afternoon, everyone. Welcome. Once again, we're offering another program with Arthur Bergeron from Eric McConnell. And today we're going to be presenting a presentation called Creating Dementia-Friendly Community, which is one of the topics that we're beginning to talk about now. So this presentation is very timely. And along with Arthur, we have three presenters. Sandy Cordobi, who you've met in our past programs. Victoria Hasselbach, who is the outreach coordinator for the Agatown Council on Aging. And Brenda Costa, who works with Arthur and America Kong.
That's right. My famous paralegal.
Yes.
Who finally gets to be in the show this time.
Yes. So welcome, and there are sandwiches and refreshments in the back. Thank you.
Joyce, thank you so much. And thank you very much for your hospitality and welcoming us back to the Tisbury Council on Aging. And thank you, folks, for coming. This presentation is not your usual legal seminar where I'm trying to kind of teach you or about a couple of, you know, basic legal principles about various programs or whatever. It really came from something a little bit broader than that. As you folks know, you have seen my presentations for a long time, and so you know about my friends Frank and Mary and their children Peter, Paul, and Mary Jr., and you know that their goal in life is to live in their house and die and be buried in the backyard, right? And I've talked about them a lot, but they look, you know, it's interesting when I see Frank and Mary. These people were actually drawn by Brenda Costa's son, who is a multi-talented person. But the more I look at them, I realize they even kind of look like my parents, you know? They have that kind of same look. And I found myself, and they are like a lot of my clients. As I tell people, most of my client's average age is 76. Oh, I should go through the intro. So for anybody who hasn't seen me before, my name is Arthur Bergeron. I'm an attorney. I do nothing but elder law. I work at a firm called Myrick O'Connell. There are 60 of us. The other 59 do something else. So that I get to just do this, which is what is of interest to me. So my typical client, as a matter of fact, almost all my clients are only talking to me because they're worried about getting Alzheimer's, or they have it, or somebody that they know has it. Alzheimer's or other diseases that cause dementia. And I find myself saying, and of course a lot of the planning that I find myself doing with them is planning so that they can do something that they absolutely don't want to do, which is to go to a nursing home. Everybody dreads this notion of going to a nursing home because they really just want to stay home. And so I found myself saying, so, you know, beyond the legal stuff that I do, is there are broader policy questions here about whether we can actually design a community or have a community in which you can just stay home, no matter how bad your memory is. Because I think the interesting thing that I find in talking to my clients about Alzheimer's and other diseases that cause dementia is, you know, the good news about Alzheimer's is that it doesn't hurt. You know, I mean, and if I had to choose between having a bad back and having a bad memory, I'll take a bad memory. And I was just talking to a lady earlier today who was doing some planning around these issues because she's worried she might end up in a nursing home because she has degenerative back problems and is in pain all the time. I'd rather go another way. So the question is, can you have a community? And the other thing I think about dementia, I really believed, when my mother had it, you know, and my mother died in a nursing home, and when she had it, at that time, they kind of didn't even call it Alzheimer's, and you thought that as you people got to call it Alzheimer's, that Alzheimer's had a set of symptoms, and they were all bundled together, and there were all these physical ones, which were all related to memory, right? People getting worse, their memories getting worse and worse, and then there were these others, which were mostly psychological, which were mostly like depression and anxiety and anger and apathy and these terrible things, which I have really come to believe are totally secondary symptoms of dementia. They are not what happens, what Alzheimer's causes. They are not the immediate cause. They are people's reactions to the fact they're losing their memories, either because they're so angry about it or irritated about it themselves, or because they're reacting to the way that people treat them. because people treat people funny sometimes when they have dementia. So I really wanted to, I found myself thinking, so is there a way that you can kind of deal with this globally? And actually, I found myself really thinking about it when I went to a presentation by someone who comes to the island here. There's a guy named John Zeisel, who summers in West Tisbury. But he has actually been kind of one of the inventors of the really the movement. He calls it the I Am Still Here Foundation, right? The movement to really maintain the dignity of folks who have dementia and the way that they are treated. And I remember being in a seminar and asking him about this question. He said, that's absolutely it. The key to this is community-based. So what I found myself doing is I contacted the Alzheimer's Association, because we deal with them a lot, and I said, so is there any place that has actually tried to do this? Tried to really look at this as a community-based matter? And they said, well, actually, yes, we've heard about this initiative in Minnesota, where folks where there has been a program to really encourage communities to develop their own special program for how they can become a dementia-friendly community, and it's been going for several years. So we learned about this and checked them on Google and found them, and it seemed really interesting. And so Myrick O'Connell actually paid for to have our three senior center directors from my town, Marlborough, and the neighboring towns of Hudson and Northborough, together with the woman who runs our version of Elder Services of Cape Cod and the Islands. In our area, it's called Bay Path Elder Services. And we all went to Minnesota for 2 days of training in Minneapolis, actually, across the street from Mall of America. How exciting, got to see Mall of America too. But we were going really for kind of two reasons. One was to see if this was all just smoke and mirrors, you know? Because you hear about these programs and you see the hype, you go, and then you get there sometimes and it's just not real. So what we found was actually that it was real, and that communities had been working through small state grants to develop dementia-friendly programs over 5 or 6 years and had done a number of implementations. And so we really got interested in it and then came back. And now, like right now, in those three communities, each one of those Council on Aging directors has developed an action team. And we're going to talk a little bit about what the process is that they went through in Minnesota. And Brenda's going to talk a little bit about that. Because Brenda, in her day job is working for me, but her fun job is that she is the president right now of Bay Path Elder Services, their version of Elder Services of Cape Cod and the Islands, because she's really interested in these issues. So we came back, and so everybody is doing this, and I'm actually on the action team in my hometown, you know, in Marlborough. But what I found was in talking to folks who are getting interested in this, I find that they'll say, well, you know, that's a really interesting notion, dementia-friendly community. But then they'll kind of say, so what does that mean exactly? You know, what does it mean exactly? And so Brenda and I started looking around, and we looked like around a lot of places, because of course you've got the internet, so you can find this stuff. And what we found was there were a lot of people who were doing this. So I wanted to talk to you a little bit about this. And one of the reasons is while we are in the Bay Path area, Bay Path is, there are 14 communities, so we're starting in these three. But Bay Path is assuming that if this works, they're gonna go to some other communities. I think I'm really hoping that Elder Services of Cape Cod and the Islands will do something similar. And I know that there's real interest in Falmouth in doing this. And I was in Nantucket, I was in the other island last week. And I know that there's interest there. There were several folks from the Council on Aging there. And one of the reasons why, and when I'm on the mainland, I often talk about Martha's Vineyard because, well, you know, on the mainland, I'm sure you find the same thing. People have a lot of stereotypes about who lives on Martha's Vineyard, right? And the stereotype that they never get is the one real stereotype, which is that it's this amazing kind of community place. It's a place unlike any place I'd ever been before I came here, in the sense that people have of living together in a community and needing to kind of help each other out. So in many ways, it's the ideal place to be thinking out how to make this happen, because in many ways it's already happening. And that's one of the reasons I asked Victoria Hasselbarth to come. Is it Hasselbarth or Hazelbarth?
Hazelbarth.
Hazelbarth. Thank you very much. Right. to talk about the memory cafe that has evolved here and really about some of the programs that are evolving through the Councils on Aging here. So the purpose of this program is to give you a sense of kind of what the possibilities are. So as I mentioned, if you're Frank and Mary, one of the issues, if you're Frank and Mary, is so if Mary's memory is starting to get bad, so what, you know, what does that mean? What does that mean? How can she and Frank live a meaningful life until they die? That's everybody's goal, you know. The goal is not to be able to do the New York Times crossword puzzle until you die, but to lead what you feel is a happy, meaningful life until you die. And so what we're not talking about here is the cure. Now, I know there's a lot of talk about the cure, and the drug companies talk a lot about the cure. And you keep hearing, you know, about magic things that are just over the horizon, and maybe they're going to show up, but not in time for me, probably. Certainly not in time for my older brother, who is now 78 and has an early stage diagnosis, or for my sister, who is 81, for her husband, who is 83 and is more kind of in the mid stage. The question is not the cure. The question is how to make the community be a really positive place for people who are living with this. And we've talked before about things you can do in your home. And as a matter of fact, I think I might have even had someone here, Carol DiRienzo, who is there's a group that specializes in talking to folks in their home and trying to make their home more dementia friendly and make it safer and deal with all those issues. But the bottom line is, if you're Frank and Mary, once you walk out the door of your house, you're in the neighborhood. And the question is, so how is that neighborhood dementia friendly? How can you be in that neighborhood? And because all of the neighbors have enough awareness of what dementia is and what Alzheimer's is, that they realize that it isn't like contagious, you know? And that you can have a conversation with people who have, you know, who have many stages of dementia. Can't be the same conversation that you might have had with them before. You know, you can't, and it shouldn't be a conversation where you're constantly saying, "You remember my name, don't you? You know, don't you remember that time?" You know, well, because maybe they don't, you know, so that can't be the conversation. But that's okay if folks are comfortable with the fact that you have dementia, right? And so there's no shame to having it because your neighbors are aware of it and they're not staying away from you. I have one of the woman who runs the Council on Aging in Hudson. She was doing this presentation with me, and she talked about her own mother. Her mother, who died last fall, she'd been with her mother for the last 2 years. Her mother had progressive dementia, was living in a little town in Chelmsford, about 20 minutes away. So the last year of the mother's life, every night, this woman would drive from Marlborough, where she lived with her husband, and stay with her mother every night and every weekend. And she said one of the things that really got to her was that her mother was a very social person. She was really active in the church, you know, and she did volunteer work. And she said she would see some of these old friends of her mother's and say, "So why don't you come over to visit?" "Oh, no. Oh, no. You know, your mother's not the same, right? You know, we don't know what to say. You know, we don't know what to say." Well, that's right. That's right. The mother is not the same in that her memory isn't very good, right? And they don't know what to say because they've never really thought about or worked with somebody about having a conversation that isn't built the way our typical conversations are, that isn't built around constantly talking about memories and about the future. But you can do that. That's one of the things that John Zeisel has developed. And we're going to talk about that a little bit later on when we talk about that role. How does the neighborhood work? How does the police department work? The police are crucial pieces of a dementia-friendly Martha's Vineyard, right? Because they need to not only kind of know how to spot folks who might be looking a little confused, right? But they also need, or they may want, some infrastructure to try to deal with that. Something like the Safe Return Program. I don't know, do any of the towns here have Safe Return? Where there's really a program where if you have early stages of dementia, you can actually kind of register with the police department.
This would be Alzheimer's.
Yes?
Yeah.
Yeah, in many places, and I know that one of the people that spoke on the other island was that there's a senior services officer. One of the easy parts about Nantucket is only one town, you know, so everything there's just one, right? But he has really encouraged this program. And so they've got folks that sign up. And if you sign up, then they've also, they keep a picture, right? So that if you have wandered, right, and you kind of don't, and so that they see somebody. And Joyce, what were you going to say?
There's another program that we have here called Project Lifesaver, that is implemented by the Sheriff's Department.
A project called Project Lifesaver here. And does it work the same kind of way?
It works the same sort
yes.
of way, but it's just kind of tracking device.
That's separate, and that's a separate thing, and that's this. There's a project. Actually, we're kind of like LoJack, and I know one of the things that he was talking about was you can. There's actually a national program done by the Association of Chiefs of Police, where you can actually get. Well, they actually use like bracelets and stuff,
yeah,
right? And so that if you get lost, you can be quickly found. And of course, you know, people have said, well, you know, I'm not going to wear one of those things, right? But I was speaking to someone actually in one of our towns who said, well, the interesting thing about that technology now is that it doesn't have to be a bracelet, right? Like one of the, so two interesting random stories about dementia. And of course, it isn't all the same, right? One is that, so typically, there's one woman who was telling me this, her husband will sometimes walk away, you know, and just walk away. And she's very concerned about this, but so one of the things she did was it was a very, like a little disc, right, as opposed to a bracelet, and just put it in his coat pocket, because he always wears the same coat. He always goes out, takes on the same coat, and then he goes, right? And it's got a LoJack-based device, so that they can always kind of locate him, right? But the other thing, just as a piece of trivia, I think it was Zeisel that may have mentioned this, that one of the things that research has found about folks who have dementia and kind of walk away and you're trying to find them, is that people, when they get to a corner and have to turn, with dementia, they'll turn in the direction of their major hand. So if they're right-handed, they'll always turn right. And if they're left-handed, they'll always turn left. So if you're trying to find somebody, in many cases, you just kind of take the route and just start making the correct turns, and there's reasonable likelihood of finding both. But anyway, the point is, the police department really has to be involved in this. And one of the other possibilities that I've read about is actually the increasing use of GIS. Because as you may know, if you click on your local town website, right, you can see your assessor's map, right, on the website. Because every community in Massachusetts, I believe now, has an assessor's map that is on GIS, which means every parcel is shown on those maps. Now everybody lives, every one of you, everybody here lives on one of those parcels. Which means that if it were okay to be talking about your dementia, right? And if you could just say, yeah, I've got it, you know, and so I want to be safe here, and so you knew kind of where everybody was, you could actually put that information on a data layer. One of the nice things about GIS is you can take that base data like you have on your assessor's maps, and you can overlay another data layer onto it electronically so that you could locate everybody who has dementia, which means you could also locate the neighborhoods where they are and maybe match them up with people who are going to be kind of looking out for them, especially for those folks who don't have somebody who's there all the time, who has a spouse who has to work, who has a child there who has to work. So there are a lot of things that you can do once you're conscious, once you've gotten rid of the embarrassment of it, and once you're really kind of thinking about this. So what about the fire department? Similarly, now I can't remember this here. When the ambulance goes to somebody's house, right, when there's an emergency and the ambulance goes, is that run by the fire department here, or is there a separate ambulance service?
EMTs.
They're EMTs? But are the EMTs run by the town, or are they privately run? They're run by the town. So that's who shows up, right? So one of the challenges for all of the firemen, because they're dealing with this regularly, right, is to have the kind of training to know what to do, right? Ideally, they know where people are and who has dementia, but also to kind of just to know what to do. Like you get there and there's an emergency and someone's on the floor and they fell, you know, and they've got dementia. The first question isn't what happened, you know, wrong question, you know. So you need to kind of be able to figure that out, and you need to have the firemen get over their prejudices. You often will hear firemen, maybe not in Martha's Vineyard, but certainly at home, talking about the frequent flyers. Oh, those are just the frequent flyers. We're at their houses all the time, you know? And it's a lot of these folks, It's a lot of these folks. But to have that be a more positive thing. I mean, imagine how stressful it is anyway to be have fallen down and you're older and you're on the floor. But imagine, and you've got dementia too. So you're not exactly sure what happened, you know? And this guy's coming in that you don't know, right? By the way, so here's a trivia question. So why is it when they show up at the door that the ambulance comes and the fire truck always shows up too? Anybody know why that is? It's because the fire truck, the fireman is the only guy that can go through the door without a warrant, right? The ambulance person can't, and the policeman can't without a warrant, but the fireman can go through the door. So that's why you think they're wasting your tax dollars when they're all showing up like that. But there's actually a reason, and that is the reason. So what about the hospital? What about the hospital? What about when a person with dementia has fallen or whatever and is now in triage, right? With their typically with their caregiver, who often is the person who has their healthcare proxy too. And the nurse is talking to the person. So what happened? Oh, nothing. Nothing happened. I'm fine. And the caregiver is going, dementia, you know. But the triage nurse, the training of the triage nurse is you're supposed to just talk to the patient, right? And there are real confidentiality issues here, you know. And so why can you be talking? You're just supposed to be talking to the patient. So I'm not saying that there's not an automatic answer to that. But in a dementia-friendly Martha's Vineyard, right, every one of those triage people has done training around folks with dementia so they can be dealing with those issues all the time. Similarly at the medical clinics, you really got two different kinds of sets of issues. You've got the nurses, right, and you've got the doctors. So the nurses, you've got these similar kinds of training issues around dealing with folks who've got dementia. For the doctors, I think, a lot of it is a matter of getting the doctors to do the screenings early. And maybe, once again, it's different here. But I know of a lot of situations where folks say the general practitioners, they don't make that an automatic part of exams. They kind of don't do it unless you're asking them to do it. And in many cases, don't want to bring it up because they don't want the conflict that inevitably ensues. I'm fine. What do you mean? Right? Or the spouse. He's fine. She's fine. You know? So they need to be doing the screenings. They need the training for it. I'm not going to go through that. But also, they need to be knowing that in many cases they should be referring people to specialists, right? If they're at all not sure of the cause of the dementia, because while it is true that Alzheimer's disease causes about 70% of the cases of dementia, that's only 70%, right? So 3 out of 10 people with dementia, there's some other problem. How many people have heard of Lewy body disease? Lewy body disease. That's more than most places. That's about 10%, right? I've actually heard of it. I've heard of Lewy body called the most common disease that no one's ever heard of. A disease, a set of whose symptoms are dementia symptoms, but they also have others like hallucinations. Supposedly Robin Williams, who recently committed suicide, was suffering from Lewy body disease. Can you imagine Robin Williams having hallucinations? You know, the notion of that. So you really need folks who are trained. You need nurses who are trained. You need them to be referring to specialists. When you go to the drugstore, are the folks who are there at the drugstore aware? First of all, is there some kind of a registry? Of course not, because it hasn't happened at this point, of folks who have got dementia, so that you know that you may be dealing with some of those issues. That's something that was done actually nationwide in Austria in conjunction with the Austrian Alzheimer's Association, just to try to reduce the problems with folks who have got dementia getting drugs that actually are negatively affecting their diseases. What about when you go to a restaurant? What about Frank and Mary, who have always gone to the Little House, right? Right? Or the Black Dog, right? And you go and you've always been. Or what is the diner in Oak Bluffs? The standard? Linda Jean's, right? So you've got people who've been going to Linda Jean's for 20 years, right? And now they're going, and I don't know, because many of you have gone to Linda Jean's. Maybe the staff there get it, right? And don't have these issues. But if you've got dementia and you're walking in, you don't need a menu with 30 items. You know, you need, so Mr. Bergeron, would you like the fish today or the chicken, right? Or even easier, Mr. Bergeron, the chicken's really good today. How about the chicken? You know? So maybe there are a bunch of pieces, and that's such a crucial piece. Because if you're just kind of older in general, I mean, if you're just kind of you in general, but if you're retired or older, what do you do? What do you do on a typical day, right? You're at home, and you go for a walk maybe, and you go to the store. I mean, you go to a certain set of things, and for a lot of people, a piece of that is going to the restaurant, going to a that you've been going to for years. And you don't need to have the waitress who is basically, oh, so you did this order, and then the food shows up and the food is wrong. And by the way, this is another story that came from one of the other Council on Aging people. And the food is wrong and the waitress is getting angry at the person because the person with dementia said, I didn't order that. Oh yes, you did. Of course you did. It's right here. Well, yeah, great, right? And then starts talking past the person with dementia. Oh, didn't your husband do a great job with that meal? Isn't that wonderful? You know? And you're the husband and you're listening to this, you know? So there are all these like little things about a restaurant where the staff needs to be, at least some of them need to be trained, right? There needs to be a different menu. Maybe the signage needs to be clearer. Maybe there need to be special hours, right, where folks are coming in who have dementia. Maybe you want to do something like a memory cafe. What is a memory cafe? Well, as it happens, you have one here on Martha's Vineyard. And Victoria runs it. No, it doesn't run it. Victoria is one of the founders of the memory cafe. And I wanted her to talk a little bit about it and how it was kind of a natural progression from the work that you do with the Center for Living. Victoria.
Thank you, Art. I'm Victoria Hazelbarth, and I'm the outreach worker at the Edgartown Council on Aging. I'm also a member of the Dukes County Health Council, and I serve on the Healthy Aging Task Force. And I'm sure most of you are familiar with the Healthy Aging Task Force. They've been around for a while. They were the ones who sent you those surveys, rather intensive surveys, last October that I hope all of you filled out. One of the reasons for the surveys is to determine gaps in services that are offered to seniors. And one of the gaps that we determined was existent was in Alzheimer's care. You know, the thing with Alzheimer's is it's growing in leaps and bounds. Right now there's 5.1 million people suffering from Alzheimer's alone, and a lot of them haven't been diagnosed. Generally, when someone walks into their doctor's office and says, I'm getting forgetful, I suspect that there's something wrong, in 55% of the cases, that doctor does nothing. There's something stigmatized right now about having memory loss that doctors really are leery about going up against. I think part of that is that the diagnosis is sometimes very difficult to make and very costly. So rather than the doctor saying, you have dementia, I'm not sure what kind, and rallying forces together, rallying the family together, they just send that person forth without any formal diagnosis. And it's a very, very disquieting thing because within the next 25 to 30 years, our senior population over the age of 65 is going to double. So we're going to be faced with a virtual tsunami of issues in communities that are unprepared. So the island is trying to close the gap and become better prepared and make our island an Alzheimer's friendly one. And we're doing several things. One of them, as Art had mentioned, is to create a memory cafe, which actually sprang forth from the memory support groups that we run here every Wednesday up at Featherstone Center for the Arts. And we've been doing them for about 4 years now, ever since this need was identified. Interestingly, when Nancy Langman and I began 4 years ago, there were about three or four people in the memory loss support group. And they originally met at community services and essentially outgrew their space and needed to have more resources being aimed at them, art and music, and gallery space and all of the richness that people who have memory loss benefit from. So we made the transition up to Featherstone, and our population of people who were attending the group began to grow. We went from 3 or 4 people up to 12 people to 20, and at one time, you know, we had 32 people enrolled, and we realized, wow, we can't contain all of these people in one room. So we ended up dividing the group in two. So we have two groups that meet every Wednesday, back to back, at Featherstone Center for the Arts. The first group meets between 9:30 and 11. The second group meets between 11 and 12:30. And the beauty of the group is that we've become like a family. People feel comfortable in the group. They share their dreams and ambitions and concerns. They share art therapies, which have been determined to actually stimulate the memories of people experiencing memory loss. We bring music to the group, again, a great memory stimulator, and we have refreshments and good times. So that's one element of the gap that has been rapidly closed. From that group, we developed the Memory Cafe. In fact, Art Bergeron, our one of our hosts today, he let us know about a grant. And we just received $11,000 to help fund our Memory Cafe for the next year.
So Money follows good ideas.
We are so delighted. The Memory Cafe has been meeting for about 2 years now. It's currently at the Legion Hall. It's every Thursday between 10 and noon. It's a more informal version of what we offer on Wednesday at the Memory Support Group. So if you're interested in what we do, I suggest stopping by. It's open to the public between 10 and 12, and there's music and refreshments, card playing, and a lot of educational materials available for anyone who stops in. We're hoping to continue this indefinitely moving into the future. The last part of the gap that we really need to fulfill, and we've talked about it, is creating a real dementia-friendly community in providing outreach and resources for businesses and service providers to learn how to identify a senior citizen who is perhaps without a caregiver and compromised in some way. We're talking about that on the Healthy Aging Task Force. We've had meetings about it. The program actually used to exist here on the island in the early 1990s, modeled after one of the first national dementia-friendly communities out in Oregon. And it was run by Elder Services and the Martha's Vineyard Center for Living. And it went okay for a few years. You know, these organizations provided business owners and the police force with training, kept up an active mailing list, mailed out brochures, posters, training material. But then the program fell by the wayside gradually because it's a lot to manage a program like that. So we need to come up with ideas to create a unified front, an organization that is going to really be at the helm in running this program, and a good committee, a good strong committee that is willing to do trainings in the different towns, train the police force, the EMTs, and train business owners in what to look for. And that's going to happen. You know, it's not a long way off. I want to share with you, before I conclude, a little anecdote that happened to me recently up at Kronig's Market. I was there on a Saturday morning about 2 or 3 months ago, and I was in the checkout line, and having just paid, I noticed there was a woman, obviously with dementia. She was confused. She was putting all sorts of things in her shopping cart. And she cut in front of me and went up to the cashier and said, you know, I really need to use your phone right now. I'm confused. I don't know what to buy. So the cashier led her to a public phone, which was actually very near the checkout area, but she had forgotten her phone number. And she became very anxious and distressed and raised her voice. And so that all attention was diverted to her, the other cashier at the other register had to leave their post to intervene. one of the young cashiers rolled her eyes and thought, wow, you know, this woman must be crazy. When in actuality, you know, this woman had significant dementia, shouldn't have been alone, and had probably and definitely shouldn't have been driving. So, you know, I was watching this unfold, and I saw Steve Bernier, the owner of Kronig, standing outside, and I trotted out to him, introduced myself, and told him what was unfolding in the store. And he was raking and tending one of his flower beds, and, you know, his face went ashen, and he dropped his rake, and he started running for the store, and he looked at me, and he threw his hands up and said, "What do I do?" And had he been trained, had we really been a truly dementia-friendly community, he would have known exactly what to do. He would have known how to de-escalate the situation. He would have known what entities to call, the local council on aging, if it were during working hours, the police if it were not. And this poor woman would have been more than likely in a registry at the police force, at the police station, so she could have been returned to her home. So my hope for the future is we can all pull together and make this a dementia-friendly community that's going to be beneficial to all.
Victoria, thank you very, very much.
Thank you, Art.
So there's wonderful things really happening, you know? And the fact that there's already a memory cafe, and as a matter of fact, it turned out when we started doing the research here in my hometown, that the first memory cafe was developed in Marlborough and is still going there. It was developed a number of years ago. An interesting thing that we found looking nationally was that many of the memory cafes actually now are starting to show up in, of all places, cafes, right? You're ending up with restaurants like this one, which actually is in Minnesota, J. Arthur's, where on Saturdays from 2 to 4 in one of the rooms there, when of course, I mean, how many people are at a restaurant at 2 to 4 on a Saturday afternoon, right? And they run it as a cafe and encourage folks with dementia and their caregivers to come, and they serve food and stuff, and they have music and other stuff. So I think one of the goals, and there's an entity now in Massachusetts that is actually trying to coordinate all of the dementia-friendly, or all of the these memory cafes, because there are increasing numbers showing up. I think the goal being to really give people an opportunity, if you're at home, you have, you know, early mid-stage dementia, that literally there's some place you can go to get out of the house and not feel trapped once a week, at least once a week, that there's some interesting place. Now, imagine that in the Martha's Vineyard context. So how many places are there where that would be ideal? You know, whether it is the movie theater, right? Or Featherstone, or the terrific Arboretum. There are so many places where it could really work, but the people there need to be trained, because this needs to be a happy place. This needs to be a good experience. One of my I mentioned the Pleasantries. My brother-in-law goes there. And as my sister says, she'll often be driving him home. She'll say, "How was your day?" "Oh, I had a wonderful day." "What did you do?" "I have no idea." But that's okay. At the end of the day, when you're going to bed, do you need to remember what happened all day? No, you need to know it was a good day. You just need to know that it was a good day. Similarly in the grocery store, and I think those are great stories, Victoria, those are great stories about, so whether it is a matter of having special staff, trained staff who are there, even if it isn't all the staff, and dealing with that as a process matter, because there are obviously new staff coming in all the time, or having better signs, right? Or giving people actual help as there is a chain, actually, there is this one interesting chain, there's a supermarket in Tesco in Chester in England, where they've really focused on this issue. There were a number of these initiatives that have happened, interestingly, especially in the United Kingdom. There's a lot of information. And actually, the owner of this store said, he talks about the training and the things that he's done. He said it's like making mental ramps. You know, back before you didn't have ramps, right? Right? So everybody had a wheelchair. You never could get in. And so now there's ramps every place. Well, think of them as mental ramps. Because you've got people who are there, it's not like they're not there, you know. It's just that they're there and they've got some disabilities, but they, with some help, they can be, you know, have a nice day. And so similarly, by the way, there was a chain of stores that we found in New Zealand that they committed to do this for all of their supermarkets across New Zealand. But New Zealand is not that big, so that meant like 17 supermarkets. That was like all of New Zealand. So the owner did it, well, because, no, guess what? Because he had a family member who had gone through this, right? And so we invited all the store managers from the 17 stores for training so that they could then train their own staff about these issues. And said, so how many of you have had an experience that one of your family or friends has had dementia? 15 out of 17. 15 out of 17 of those store people, of the managers, right? So all of a sudden, everybody was engaged, right? Similarly at the bank. In the bank, you've got two kinds of issues. One is simply helping people who are there to deal with some of the basic banking if they're having some trouble. Because banking can be kind of confusing, right? I mean, it's all numbers and writing things down and all this stuff. There's another piece, though, and that is having some kind of system to spot the guy that's there with the niece or nephew that no one's ever seen before, and all of a sudden there's a check for $20,000 or $30,000 that's being written out, you know, and somebody's being added to the account. What's that about, right? Not that that's necessarily bad, but in a dementia-friendly community, there's somebody that's saying, can somebody be checking on this? You know, I mean, I see a lot of this in my business, right? I mean, there are some very, and it isn't, you know, you always talk about it in terms of these, you know, far away scam artists, blah, blah, blah. These are typically relatives. I mean, to be honest, these are typically relatives, right, who are taking advantage. And the place where they're taking advantage is right there, at the bank. So there needs to be some kind of way for us to be protecting ourselves when those situations are occurring. It's really important. Oh, that I already told you the New Zealand story. So that's kind of what Frank and Mary would like, that there's actually a little symbol outside the store. Frank and Mary are welcome here. I won't talk about the mall. That obviously isn't quite applicable to here. But what about parks? Once again, if you're at home and you're having a day, and what do you do during your day? I mean, you're at home and you eat, you know, and you watch some TV, and maybe you go to the park, right? Well, interestingly, but the park can be a great place. It's a public place. Right? It's a place where you are getting outside, so you're keeping your kind of day-night orientation, which is so easy to lose if you're constantly in the house, especially for folks who have dementia. You're getting exercise. You're trying to design spaces, though, that are unobstructed so that nobody's getting lost in that space and they're flat. Right? So if you go to the Seattle, Parks and Recreation Department website, they have spent a lot of time working on this. So they've got not only a number of parks that have been, I want to say, not necessarily specially designed, but really maintained so that they are flat and they have these kinds of qualities to them. But they also, Parks and Rec runs tours in conjunction with the senior centers, with the councils on aging there, of families, you know, once again, caregivers and folks with dementia. So it's like, in many ways, the Memory Cafe. That there's a regular time or a regular day of the week where you go. Actually, they also have a drumming circle for those with dementia and their caregivers. That must be a very entertaining drumming circle. So in every piece of the community, you can kind of think how that would apply. In a dementia-friendly community at the Tisbury Library, or at least at the set of libraries that are here who are constantly working with each other, if you want to read about these issues, there's a lot that's available. So you can, if you're a caregiver, you can go in, you can talk about these things. The senior center in that kind of community just plays this crucial role in that it is kind of like it's the protector. The senior center in many ways is the protector of all these folks, especially those folks who don't have a caregiver who is right there who can be working with them all the time. It's a center of activities like this one is, right? Where the Center for Living has been coming for years and years, right? Two days a week, right? You're constantly trying to figure out how to take care of those seniors. Because you've got exercise programs, you've got caregiver support. There are so many things that you can do. So in a dementia-friendly community, I think, this is just me, and this, an assisted living is a really helpful thing. A place where if you just can't be living at home by yourself, there is an environment which is just safer, where you don't have to be doing the shoveling, you know, and you don't have to be really remote. And there's probably a memory care community within that community for folks who have got who've got some issues, right, but just can't be living by themselves. As it happens, the other island has one of these, right? They had one and it got built about 10 years ago, but the demand was bad, and so it went bankrupt. And it went privatized. But guess what? They just bought it back. They just got a group of people together, locals, and bought back their own assisted living community, which is really, in many ways, I mean, I think they get it. It's going to be not only the center of the place to go if you get to the point that you can't be living at home, but also the kind of the center of education. The places that John Zeisel runs, the assisted, he runs memory care communities within several assisted livings, one of them in my hometown in Marlboro. And of course, they're dealing with these issues every day. And so you've got staff every day who are at the end of the shift saying, so how did things go today? Oh, geez, you know, we were dealing with Frank today, and this happened, and geez, things went all downhill. Well, how did you deal with that? And people are constantly trading information. So they end up being the best place for people to go for more training, for people to go for caregiver support, for a whole bunch of things, right? And then, so they can do a lot of things. And finally, the dreaded nursing home. What about the nursing home in that dementia-friendly community? The place which, in most communities, has kind of like a psychological moat around it. You know, and someone goes to the nursing home, it's like, bye. I guess they're gone now, you know. And kind of no one visits, certainly no one but family visit, right? Even though it's fairly close, right? And they tend to be big. You know, when people talk to me about nursing homes, oh, don't ever, I remember my mother, oh, please don't ever send me to a nursing home. You know, how many spouses have been totally guilted out by that line, right? So, but the question is that what a nursing home has to be? Well, in a dementia-friendly community, maybe it doesn't. You know, maybe it needs to be a greenhouse, more greenhouse model nursing home, like Patty Moore and the folks that are here are really looking at. A nursing home in which the model isn't this kind of medical model, like it's like a hospital for people who aren't quite that sick, but rather more of a halfway house model where the staff is kind of interacting with you and where there's a maximum number of rooms. And that's why it has to be owned by the community. It can't be for profit, right? Because this thing is never going to make big money. Because you make big money by having a big place, and so you're getting economies of scale. Except who wants to live in that place? But if it's 20 people and everybody's got their own room and it's around kind of a central dining area and the folks who can still do it are helping doing the meal preparation, which these primarily tend to be women, right? And a lot of these people spend a lot of time doing meal preparation in their lives, right? So they actually enjoy a lot of that, you know? So it's a very different kind of place. But that's only a place that can't exist except in a community that is dementia-friendly. And finally, what about Frank? What about Frank? In a dementia-friendly community, what does he need? Well, he needs education so that he can be talking to his wife that he thought he knew, but now she doesn't know his name anymore, and that's very upsetting to Frank, right? How does he deal with all that stuff? How does he get the support? So I asked my friend Sandy Cordolby to come, because many of you have seen Sandy, because she's been here with me on presentations, and their company is the only geriatric care manager firm here. So, but a piece of geriatric care management is trying to find the home care people who are working with you in your home. So I asked Sandy to come just to talk about, from her perspective in a dementia-friendly community, what is needed? What is needed to make this place dementia-friendly in those ways? Could you talk about that for a few minutes?
I could.
Thank you.
And I do know most of you. I own a company called Horizons Geriatric Care Management. My business partner is Beth Toomey, who you knew as the chief of police in West Tisbury. Beth has her master's in clinical mental health, and she helps with the mental health side of this. We have 86 families that we're taking care of on the island right now, and about a dozen on the mainland. And we do a lot of what Arthur is talking about. We help find programs. We educate families. We support families. We do a lot of long-range planning and some short-range planning, help people get home from the hospital. One of the things that we do a lot of is helping families get their loved one that has dementia or some other difficult medical diagnoses. I have one lady right now that's got congestive heart failure, COPD and diabetes all together. You know, any one of those is a real problem, but this woman is very sick with all three of them, and she's only in her early 70s. The average age of my client right now is 84. And so we're trying to get as much help for her as we possibly can. And one of the things that we need the dementia-friendly communities to help us with is to educate and to have the resources. One of the things that I do a lot of is get folks like that lady onto federal programs for insurances that will help pay for care either in her home or pay for her to go to a nursing home. Because the bottom line is if she needs to go to a nursing home and she doesn't have long-term care insurance, she has no payer. Medicare does not pay for nursing home. So without long-term care insurance or MassHealth, there's no payer for nursing home. And so, or if she needs a lot of care at home, where's that going to come from and who's going to pay for that? So we're helping folks get onto MassHealth through the Choices Program, through Elder Services, and the Councils on Aging have been amazingly helpful with this. And once I get you onto that federal program, you can be eligible for unlimited home care from a CNA or a companion, whatever you need. If you have Alzheimer's and your husband needs to go out and do the grocery shopping and get the pharmacy done and get the mail done and maybe even have a cup of coffee with some friends, somebody's got to be with the wife because she can't be left alone. Who's going to pay for that? To pay for that privately in the community we live in, it's about $25 an hour. So if you want to go out for 2 or 3 hours, 2 or 3 times a week, that's a lot of money. So we helped get folks onto federal programs that will pay for it, and we're successful at that. We had two that got their MassHealth cards today, or this today. And the problem with that is now they're eligible for 40 to 50 hours worth of care in their home, but it has to go through Elder Services. Elder Services has to contract with local agencies to have the staff come out, and the agencies don't have any staff. So we go through tens of thousands of hours of work to get everything set up, get you all ready. You now have your card in hand and you're ready to have home care, and you've done all of that work and you did an amazing job, and I can't get you the help that you need because we don't have the human resources on Martha's Vineyard. We need training, we need a way. I taught a CNA program, I taught 9 students last March. They're all out working. They get sort of sucked up into the community. And my philosophy is, let's just keep teaching. Let's keep creating certified nursing assistants with training in Alzheimer's and dementia care and all the other things that CNAs need to do. And let's just get them into the community. Just flood the community with them. Who cares where they go to work? Go to Windermere, go to the assisted livings, go to VNA, go to Greater Boston, go to Best of Care. Who cares? Let's just get them into the community because then we're all going to benefit. And the training has come to a bit of a halt. I think actually today, Windermere starts a program, which is great. They'll have 10 more ready to go. It's harder to get that done than you think. And it certainly is financially difficult for a lot of kids that want to do this. Or somebody whose youngster just went off to kindergarten and now they could work mother's hours, but they've got to come up with about $1,100 and about 50 hours of their time in order to take the course and become certified. And that can be a barrier. So maybe one of the things that we need to try to figure out is, how do we help that along? How do we make sure that we can run these programs? One very quick story. Last winter, I was pulling out of my office, which is right next door to Vineyard Scripps. It was about 10 o'clock in the morning, and it was about 20 degrees with a wind chill probably of 0. As I pulled out to come out onto State Road, there was an elderly woman walking towards my car from up by Packers, as if she was going to Main Street, Vineyard Haven, or Five Corners. As I looked at her, she had no hat, no gloves. She had on a light windbreaker and clearly her nightgown and sneakers. So I stopped, she had that look in her eye like she was terrified. So I rolled down the window of my car and I stopped, and she walked right over to my car. And I said, "Do you need some help? Are you okay?" And she said, "No, I'm just going home." And I said, "Where's home?" And she said, "County Road." Really? So she was going the wrong way. So I said, "What is your name?" And when I asked her name, she became upset. And I said, "Don't get upset. I just want to see if I can help you. You must be very cold." And I said, "Where are you going?" And she said, "Right there." And she pointed to Net Result. She became upset with me asking her questions. And she said, "Never mind, never mind." And she walked away. So I pulled over into the gas station so I could keep an eye on her, and I called 911. I said, there's an elderly woman who is standing beside Net Result, and she needs help right away. So they were sending a police officer over. In the meantime, I called Beth, my business partner, because she'd know what to do with that. And the police officer arrived, and as he was arriving, I was still on the phone with 911. You can hear my voice shaking. I was so upset about this. And the bus pulled up. Just as the police officer was pulling into the parking lot to park by Net Result, the bus pulled up, the VTA bus, and she started to get on it. So I said to the 911 person, I said, she's going to get on the bus. Tell the cop she's going to get on the bus. And she did. But he went and he got her off. She walked down the two steps. She talked to him for a few minutes. She went back up the two steps, and the bus drove off with her, and he's standing there. So I went over to him, and I said, what happened? And he said, oh, she was just going to Edgartown. Her daughter lives in Edgartown. I said, she just told me that she lived in Mashpee and that she lived on County Road and that she was going to buy fish at the fish market. And did you notice that she's in her nightgown? And he said, oh, no, I didn't. I said, where's that bus going? And he said, I don't know. So he called and he found out the bus was going to Oak Bluffs. And then our not-quite-so-dementia-friendly community, he called his sergeant at the police station to see if he could follow the bus to Oak Bluffs, and the sergeant said, no, that's out of town. So Beth did what she could to call the VTA and let them know that they had somebody on the bus that was very disoriented. I actually met the woman at the hospital. She was from Mashpee. She had gotten on the boat that day in her nightgown. It was really difficult. So what we need is a lot more help in our community to help folks so that we can keep them safe.
Thank you.
So there's a lot of stuff that's needed. There's a lot of training that is needed. We've talked about that. There's facilities that are needed. There's programs that are needed. There's a lot of stuff. And all of that is going to cost money. And so the question then is, if we're really going to do this, so where's that money going to come from? There are a few possibilities. Maybe it's going to come from the sky, right? Maybe if we just pray for it, oh my God, if only there were a lot of money. And the kind of non-religious version of that is, maybe there's a big foundation. There's a big foundation, some faraway place that's going to send us a lot of money. Well, maybe, you know, I wouldn't count on that. Or maybe the government will. Maybe the federal government will just give us huge amounts of money to do all of these things, you know? And if it's Bernie Sanders, maybe, you know? We got a shot. Donald Trump, not so much, you know? I don't think, right? But I don't think in any event we should be kind of counting on that kind of money. Where's the money going to come from? Well, you know, it's probably going to come from here. You know, if this is important, I think money follows good ideas. If this is important to the community, then the community is going to figure it out. Now, there are three communities that are trying to figure it out right now, as I mentioned, through the program that we're calling Come to Be Dementia Friendly. I just wanted Brendan to talk about that a little bit, since, as I said, she's this big cheese, you know? I mean, out there, I just work for her, right? Can we just talk a little bit about that program? Thank
you. Okay, so this is the program that has been started in Marlboro, Hudson, and Northboro in our communities, and it's a Bay Path initiative. However, it is not supposed to be run by Bay Path, and it's not supposed to be run by the COAs, even though the directors are involved. It's really a grassroots, volunteer-driven project. And so, So we're running by the Act on Alzheimer's Toolkit. Now, Arthur talked about going to Minnesota, and this is the toolkit that is used, and we are copying it. We're just following it. It's all set up. We don't have to create the wheel. We're just following it as it's laid out by them. In fact, the Dementia Friendly America, which came out of the Conference on Aging, the White House Conference on Aging, is using the same toolkit on their website. So this is kind of what it looks like. The different sectors in a community, so that wherever anybody goes in the community, it's dementia friendly, it's dementia inclusive. So these are the populations that we have. I know down here it's much different. I did look it up, and I think by the 2010 census, there's like 16,500 residents year-round, and of those, 2,700 are over 65. And so if this is true, the one out of nine, that means there's 300 people on the island year-round who have Alzheimer's. That doesn't include the other dementias, and it doesn't include the ones that aren't reported. So this is kind of the toolkit. We've been in the convene stage. We've had our, we have an advisory committee, which Arthur and I are both on. And each town has had their community meeting, and each town has had their first action team meeting. And I think the second action team meeting is very soon for each town. Then you go into the assess stage. These are surveys that are going to, people are going to go out into the sectors in the community. They're going to go through the surveys. All of that data will go back to the analyze stage, which will go back to BayPath. They'll compute everything. And at the end of all this, there will be each town, and it will be different for each town, will get the data collected in a way that tells them what the need is in the community that needs to be met. And then the action teams will form their action plan, and then they will implement it. And here are some, it's in your handout, some sites you can go to look up this stuff. And here are the directors in our three towns. And Cindy Cormier is working at BayPath as the coordinator in this through a grant that BayPath got through the Metro West Health Foundation. And if you have any questions, she said, feel free to contact her. She'd be happy to help anyone. And here is the Marlboro team. And there is Arthur on the end there in his jeans. He is on that team.
Yes. And that's the goal. Frank and Mary living happily ever after. Now, I know that in many ways, once again, Martha's Vineyard being Martha's Vineyard, you're already ahead of the curve. You know, you've done so much stuff through Patty, the Healthy Aging Task Force. I know Patty Moore's done a ton of things. I know that Patty and I have actually had discussions about this because I know her sense was this really needs to be, continue to be part of that broader healthy aging as opposed to focusing on dementia. I guess we just disagree on that. I think that to me, there is a uniqueness to this challenge of this set of diseases that cause dementia, where you don't have these big medical other problems, but you do have a lot of trouble remembering stuff. And I think and the goal of having a place where you can continue to live until you die, no matter what your memory is, I think is a worthwhile thing. So thank you very, very much for taking the time to come today. I know that I didn't get a chance to teach you some interesting legal thing, which we will the next time that we come. Thank you very much to my guests. Could I have a round of applause for my wonderful guests? For such a little island, you have so many resources. It's just really wonderful. So thank you very much, and we'll see you next time. Thank you, and thank you to Joyce for inviting us again. Thank you.